Here we have a set of cutoff antlers from a Rocky Mountain elk. So I'm going to be showing you the way that we're going to be using this to measure. It's going to be measured on a method 19T for 19 typical form. As you can see, this has all typical tines coming off of it. There are no non-typical points on this whatsoever. But as in the case with any antlered game, the first thing you want to do is establish your main beam, and then you're going to be marking off your typical tines using your welding chalk or your soapstone or some pencil. I like this welder's chalk because it shows up really well and it's easy to wipe off. You're not going to wind up with pencil marks left on your antlers that you're going to have mounted on the wall, and this wipes off real easily with a wet napkin or something. But this is just my particular preference. The first measurement is going to be the main beam measurement, starting below the burr. I'm going to follow this measurement through the center of the main beam all the way around the outside of the curve to the main beam tip. It's important that you stay in the center of the main beam here to make sure that you're going to get an accurate measurement of the main beam. Then you're going to use your alligator clip to get your measurement. Once you've got your main beam measurement, the next step is to go and start measuring all of your tines. One thing that's unique to the Rocky Mountain elk that's different from all the other antlered game animals is the way that you measure your brow tine. This particular brow tine, all brow tines on the Rocky Mountain elk are going to be measured starting from the side of the tine rather than measured around the outside curve. The reason that we do this is because of the way the brow tines come out of this burr here at the bottom. If you were to measure the brow tine coming out of the bottom here of the burr, you'd be greatly increasing your measurement, which you're getting it's going to get credit in the main beam measurement and also in the way that we take our circumferences on the Rocky Mountain elk. So when we take this measurement, we're going to start here at my chalk line that I've already made, putting the tape there, going through the center of this brow tine all the way through. You're not going to be hitting the outside curve on this particular tine all the way to the tip. Then we're going to be moving to our typical tines here, and we're going to switch back to measuring the outside curve to get the longest tine measurement. Start down here at the bottom of this chalk line, hit the outside curve right there. Then we're going to move to our T3, move into the T4. Then once you've got all of your tine measurements, we're going to be starting to take our circumference measurements. The circumference locations differ on the Rocky Mountain elk from your most of your deer species, like your white-tail deer, your Rocky Mountain mule deer, desert mule deer, in the sense that there is no circumference taken in between the burr and your brow tine. The C1 is going to be in between your T1 and your T2, with your C2 being in between your T2 and your T3. The C3 being in between the T3 and your T4, and your last circumference is going to be between your T4 and what normally would be your T5. This particular elk does not have a T5, so we're going to be obtaining our C4, our last circumference measurement, by taking the length between the end of this tine and the main beam tip, and dividing that in half and getting our circumference in the middle. So as a quick example, we'll be getting our circumference here. The smallest place in between our T1 and T2, there's really only one spot to obtain this measurement. These tines are pretty close together. It's going to be right there. Then I'm going to move in here and check for where the smallest circumference is. Our C3 is going to be here between the T3 and the T4. Like so. Whenever you don't have a T5, obtaining your fourth circumference, you have to measure the distance between the end of your last tine all the way to the end of the main beam tip. And you're going to divide that in half in order to get your force circumference. So here we're starting at the end of our main beam tip. Going to measure this distance. And we're going to divide that in half to figure out where our C4 circumference location is going to be. So now that I've got the distance that I need to measure, I'm going to find that spot, go directly to it, and get my last circumference. Other than that, you would typically have a inside span measurement, but obviously with these being cutoffs, these are not going to come back together perfectly in a way that I'm confident is not going to increase the inside span. So we're not going to be taking that measurement with these cutoffs.
Should you need any more further instruction, you can always reference the SCI Measurer's Manual.